Have you ever wondered how the Catholic Church lived with the rise of Nazism? Did the clergy criticize Hitler's regime or decide to remain silent? And how did the Nazi fugitives manage to leave Europe? By whom were they helped? In this video you will learn the whole truth about the matter, with an assente basis in historical facts. The population of Germany in 1933 was about 60 million. Almost all Germans were Christians, belonging to both Roman Catholic churches, about 20 million members, and Protestant churches, about 40 million members. The Jewish community in Germany in 1933 represented less than 1% of the country's total population. How did Christians and their churches in Germany react to the Nazi regime and its laws, particularly the persecution of the Jews? The Nazi anti-Jewish ideology, based on races, converged with anti-Semitism that was historically widespread throughout Europe at the time and that had deep roots in Christian history. For too many Christians, traditional interpretations of religious scriptures emerged to support these prejudices. While Nazi anti-Semitism embraced the modern pseudo-scientific racial principles rejected by the Catholic Church, the ancient antipathies between Christianity and Judaism contributed to European anti-Semitism. These were some of the reasons why most Christians in Germany welcomed the rise of Nazism in 1933. They were also persuaded by the Declaration on Positive Christianity and Article 24 of the 1920 Nazi Party platform. We demand the freedom of all religious beliefs in the state insofar as they do not endanger the existence of the state or conflict with the moral ways and feelings of the Germanic race. The party combats the Judeo-materialist spirit at home and abroad and is convinced that a permanent recovery of our people can only be achieved from within, based on the common good before the individual good. The largest Protestant church in Germany in the 1930s was the German Evangelical Church. Most of Germany's 40 million Protestants were members of this church. Historically, the Evangelical Church of Germany saw itself as one of the pillars of German culture and society, with a tradition theologically based on loyalty to the state. During the 1920s, a movement within the German Evangelical Church emerged. It called Deutschchristen, or German Christians. The German Christians embraced many of the nationalist and racial aspects of Nazi ideology. When the Nazis came to power, this group sought the creation of a national church of the Reich and supported a Nazi version of Christianity. Bekennerkirche, the confessor church, emerged in opposition to the German Christians. Their founding document, the Barmen Confession of Faith, declared that the church's faithfulness was to God and the scriptures, and not to a worldly Führer. The most famous members of the confessing church were the theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer, executed for his role in the conspiracy to overthrow the regime, and Pastor Martin Niemöller, who spent 7 years in concentration camps for his criticism of Hitler. Several Catholic countries and populations came under Nazi rule during World War II, and ordinary Catholics fought on both sides of the conflict. The Church in Germany had faced persecution since Adolf Hitler had taken power, and Pope Pius XI accused the Nazi government of sowing a fundamental hostility to Christ and his Church. Pius XII became Pope on the eve of the war and lobbied world leaders to prevent the outbreak of the conflict. He affirmed the Vatican's policy of neutrality, but maintained ties with the German resistance. Although he was the only world leader to publicly and specifically denounce Nazi crimes against Jews, controversy began around his apparent reluctance to talk frequently about these crimes. He used diplomacy to help war victims, lobbied for peace, shared information with the Allies, and employed Vatican radio and other media to speak out against atrocities like genocide. In Mystici Corpus Christi, 1943, he denounced the murder of handicapped people. This was followed by a denunciation by the German bishops about the murder of the innocent and defenseless, including people of foreign race or descent. Hitler's invasion of Catholic Poland triggered the war. Nazi policy was more severe towards the church in the areas annexed to the Reich, such as the Czech and Slovene lands, Austria and Poland. In Polish territories, the Nazis began systematically dismantling the church, detaining its leaders, exiling its clerics, closing its churches, monasteries, and convents. Many clerics were murdered. More than 1,800 Polish Catholic clerics died in concentration camps. The head of Nazi security, Reinhard Heydrich, orchestrated an intensification of restrictions on church activities in Germany. Hitler and his ideologists Goebbels, Himmler, Rosenberg, and Bormann hoped to de-Christianize Germany in the long term. With the expansion of the war in the East, the expropriation of monasteries, convents, and church properties increased from 1941 onwards. The clergy were persecuted and sent to concentration camps, and religious orders had their properties seized. From within the Vatican, Monsignor Hugh O'Flaherty coordinated the rescue of thousands of Allied prisoners of war and civilians, including Jews. During World War II, the Catholic Church saved many thousands of Jews by issuing false documents, lobbying Axis officials, hiding them in monasteries, convents, schools, and elsewhere, including the Vatican. In 1941, most Christians in Europe lived under Nazi rule. In general, the life of their churches could continue, as long as they did not try to participate in politics. When the Nazi regime undertook the industrialized mass extermination of the Jews, the Nazis found a large number of willing participants. Academics undertook critical examinations of the origins of Nazi anti-Semitism, and although the feelings of European Catholics toward Jews varied considerably, anti-Semitism was prevalent throughout Europe. As Geoffrey Blainey, an Australian historian, wrote, Christianity could not escape some indirect guilt for the Holocaust. Jews and Christians were rivals, sometimes enemies, during a long period of history. In addition, it was traditional for Christians to blame Jewish leaders for Christ's crucifixion. At the same time, Christians showed devotion and respect. They were aware of their debt to the Jews. Jesus, the disciples, and all the authors of the Gospels were Jews. The Christians saw the Old Testament, the sacred book of the synagogues, as an equally sacred book for them. This sympathy led some lay people and clergy resistance to speak publicly against the persecution of the Jews. However, the Catholic Church in Germany was generally hesitant to speak specifically on behalf of the Jews. Although racists were rare among the Catholic hierarchy in Germany, the bishops feared that the protests against the regime would invite retaliation against Catholics. The persecution of the Jews by the Nazis worsened throughout the Third Reich era. During the prelude to the Holocaust between Kristallnacht in November 1938 and the invasion of Soviet Russia in 1941, the position of the Jews steadily deteriorated from deprivation of rights to segregation, ghettoization, and sporadic mass murder. The Vatican responded to Kristallnacht by seeking places of refuge for the Jews. Pius XII instructed the local bishops to help all those in need at the beginning of the war. On the other hand, there was no lack of anti-Semitic rhetoric from the clergy. Bishop Buchberger of Regensburg called Nazi racism directed against Jews self-defense. Bishop Hilfrich of Limburg said that the true Christian religion made its way not from the Jews, but in spite of them. Still, while clerics like Cardinal Adolf Bertram favored a policy of concessions to the Nazi regime, others, like Bishop Preysing of Berlin, called for a more concerted opposition. When the deportations for the final solution began, in his cathedral in Berlin, Father Bernhard Lichtenberg offered public prayers and gave a sermon against the deportations of Jews to the East. He was denounced and later died on his way to Dachau. After World War II, thousands of Nazis fled to South America, often with the help of Catholic clergy. In 1948, just 3 years after the end of World War II, a major Nazi war criminal escaped from a prison in Linz, Austria. Franz Stangl, a former SS Hauptsturmführer and commander of the Sobibor and Treblinka extermination camps, was responsible for the deaths of almost 1 million Jews. Through Graz, Murano, and Florence he went to Rome, and, most importantly for him, to the Vatican. In Rome, Bishop Alois Hudel, an Austrian colleague, greeted him with the words, "You must be Franz Stangl, I was waiting for you." Then he handed Stengel false documents which allowed the Nazi war criminal to travel to Syria, where his family eventually joined him. In 1951, the Stengel family emigrated to Brazil. The man who perfected mass murder in the concentration camps spent years assembling cars in a Volkswagen factory near Sao Paulo. War criminals often hid in monasteries, these routes, also known as the monastery route. Sometimes the Nazis were housed right next to their former victims, Jews heading for Israel. Rome was the next stop. The Nazis who had a letter from the Catholic Church confirming their identity were given a passport by the International Committee of the Red Cross, which issued about 120,000 documents until 1951. On March 2, 2020, the Vatican revealed archives on this matter. Historian Hubert Wolf of the University of Munster and a team of German scholars traveled to Rome for the historical revelation of the archives in early March. Wolf's team was only able to conduct research for 1 week before COVID-19 closed the archives. In this short time, they have discovered a series of documents that are not favorable to Pope Pius XII or the Catholic Church. On September 18, 1942, the future Pope Paul VI, Pius's assistant, received a report from an eyewitness of incredible carnage of Jews in Warsaw. A month earlier, Ukrainian Archbishop Andriy Sheptytsky had delivered a similar report, informing the Pope of the atrocities committed in the Lviv ghetto. Shortly thereafter, a U.S. envoy to the Vatican asked if he could corroborate reports of mass murders in Warsaw and Lviv. In response, Vatican Secretary of State Luigi Maglian allegedly said, "I don't think we have any information to confirm this serious news in detail," which was a lie. Pio's supporters, many of whom have advocated the Pope's canonization, point out that the Catholic Church has saved thousands of Jews by hiding them in churches and monasteries throughout Italy, as well as in the Vatican itself. Although the acolytes argue that Pio's inaction and silence allowed these secret actions to continue, critics cite the treatment of Jews who lived in Rome during World War II. So, do you think the church could have done something more to save the Jews? Please write your opinion in the comments. If you think someone would find this video interesting, please share it with others.